to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
The book of Proverbs says, "Whoever guards his mouth and tongue keeps his soul from trouble." Proverbs chapter 21, verse number 23. We welcome you today to our topical study of the book of Proverbs. We're so glad that you've joined us for our broadcast. And as always, we want you to know that today's lessons are being brought to you by members of the Churches of Christ. Members and congregations of the Churches of Christ would love for you to stop by and visit their worship assembly or Bible study. If you know of one in your local area, they'd love for you to drop by. If you've got a Bible question, you'd like to study the Scriptures more, or just learn what the church is about, they'd be happy to sit down and study the Word of God with you. As always, at the Gospel of Christ, we want to encourage you to visit our website, thegospelofchrist.com. We have a wide variety of Bible study materials, as well as video and audio formats that you can view. And if you'd like to have a copy of this series of lessons or any of our lessons from our website, just go to thegospelofchrist.com and fill out a media request form, and we'd be happy to send those to you free of charge. And friend, our aim at the Gospel of Christ is simply to preach the truth in love and to point men and women to what the Bible has to say. Today, our lesson for consideration is concerning the Christian and the tongue, his use of and his speech. Someone once said this. He said, "The tongue, you better watch that old tongue. It's in a wet place, it's liable to slip." And friend, that's about right. We've got to be careful with what we say, how we use the tongue, because great good or great damage can be done with our speech and our words and our actions. And so what does the book of Proverbs teach us about the Christian and his tongue? First of all, we learn that Christians need to guard. Godly people need to guard their tongue and their speech very carefully. I want you to open your Bible to Proverbs chapter 21, and I want you to turn with me to verse number 23. The Scripture records, "Whoever guards his mouth and tongue keeps his soul from trouble." When you think about the idea of guarding, you're protecting, you're putting up defenses, you're making sure that something doesn't get in or come out, kind of is the idea. We guard our house maybe with a security system, with a deadbolt on the front door, and you may have to guard something with other forms as well. We all understand the idea of guarding. You're protecting, you're keeping something safe. The Bible says whoever guards his mouth and tongue keeps his soul from a lot of trouble. And friend, how true that is. If I can learn to control what I say, you know, thinking something may be one thing. I want to control my thoughts as well, but not letting that thought come out my mouth, that's a big part of self-control as it relates to the tongue. And so guard your tongue very, very carefully. You only want to let things come out that are good and helpful and true and right. Listen to what the Bible says in Colossians chapter 4, verse number 6, concerning the Christian speech. The Word of God says, "Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each man." Our speech needs to be gracious, with salt, kind of the idea of preserving or helpful in every way, and we ought to be ready to answer. 1 Peter 3, verse 15, "Be ready always to give an answer." We want to speak the truth in love. Ephesians 4, verse 15. And friend, that doesn't mean that we can't say things that are true even if people don't really like that. That's not the idea, but why are we saying it? Galatians 4, 16, Paul said, "Have I become your enemy because I tell you the truth?" The truth and saying the truth it's part of speaking what's right and good, but our motives as well. Why are we saying that? Are we saying it with the right attitude and the right approach? And are we letting people know we're saying it out of love and we want to speak God's truth because we love people and we want them to go to heaven? And so the first guidance that we receive from the book of Proverbs on the tongue is very good. Let's guard our tongue and our speech very carefully. Watch real carefully what comes out of your mouth. Think about it before you say it. Ask yourself, is this going to be right? Is it true? Is it good? Is this helpful? What's my motive in doing that? And then be very careful what you let out of your mouth, for it can do great good or great damage to the hearers. And then as we look to the book of Proverbs, we kind of see why we need to be very careful with what we say. The book of Proverbs teaches what we say and how we use our tongue can either save or destroy other people. I want to direct your attention to the book of Proverbs chapter 18. Take your Bible and look in Proverbs 18, verse number 21 with me. The Word of God says this, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits." How is it that death and life are in the power of the tongue? Well, friend, we've got to realize the potential, what we say, and the effect that it has on other people. By saying things good and right, I can encourage people. I can lift them up. We can encourage one another. Hebrews 3 verse 13, I can lift people up. Hebrews 10 verse 24, we can promote godliness. We can promote good living, and we can give people, as it were, by our words, a good shot in the arm to keep living for Christ. Or you can do the exact opposite. By your words, you can beat down. You can knock down. You can destroy. You can discourage. And you can actually do detriment to people. And we can all think of people who've done both of these in our life. You can think of people who were great encouragers, who were always in your corner. Even when it was bad, they were there trying to lift you up and help you. And then you can think of people who everything they said was negative, they spewed venom, it was hateful, and they did more harm than you could ever imagine. Thus, we've got to be very careful what we say and how we use our tongue, because death and life are in the power of the tongue. Those who love the tongue, those who realize it's good, will eat its fruit. They can rejoice and find good things from that. But let's each be careful what you say, because its effects can do so much good or so much harm. Then from the book of Proverbs, we realize that as it relates to the godly person, especially to the child of God, we want to make sure that we use our tongues to speak the truth. That's what God wants us to do. Look in your Bible in Proverbs chapter 8, verse number 7, and I want you to notice how the proverb writer associates truth with a follower of God. Proverbs 8, 7 says this, "From my mouth will speak truth. Wickedness is an abomination to my lips." The child of God's lips also have been given to God. His tongue, his lips, his speech, all synonymous for the same thing. They belong to God. Well, what's that mean? I'm going to speak the truth. I'm going to speak what's right. You see, there's great value in the truth and in speaking it. The Bible says, Jesus speaking in John chapter 8, verse 31 and 32 said this, "You are my disciples indeed if you continue in my word, and you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free." When I speak the truth with my lips, with my tongue, when that comes out of my mouth in love, and friend, that has the ability to set people free from sin, preaching the gospel, set people free from sin, help them to point them toward God and His law, and to live the kind of life that God wants them to live. Listen to Proverbs 23:23 as it relates to the power of the truth. The Bible says this, "Buy the truth and sell it not." Friend, truth is whatever price we might have to pay, truth is such a great value, and that's why we want to speak it and we want to tell others about it. Now, we all realize as we study the Bible what truth is. John 17, verse 17, Jesus prayed to the Father, "Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. All God's commandments are true and righteous." Psalm 19 verses 6 through 9, Psalm 119 verse 160. And so the ultimate truth is God's word. And the Christian wants to speak that, wants to tell others about it in love and wants to spread the gospel. This is really the heart of what we mean in Ephesians 4 verse 15. Preach the truth, speak the truth in love. If the truth saves, and it does, then we want people to know that, and we want people to know God's love, God's mercy, and God's salvation. So a Christian ought to use his tongue to speak truth. Now, let me mention this as well. Sometimes, even when you speak the truth and you speak it in love, it's not popular. People don't like that. People don't want to hear about things that are immoral, things that are wrong, things that are ungodly, things that are contrary to the will of God. But friend, realize even then, we still have to speak the truth in love. That's why Paul said, "Have I become your enemy? Because I tell you the truth." Paul wasn't their enemy. They didn't want to hear certain truths, but Paul was still speaking the truth. And so sometimes it's easy and sometimes it's not. But the Christian needs to use his mouth, use his tongue and lips to speak the truth of God in love at all times. Then as we look to the book of Proverbs to learn about the tongue, let's also realize that God hates a tongue, speech that is used for deceptive purposes. Look in Proverbs chapter 6 with me for just a moment, and I want you to notice what the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 6. Here we've got a laundry list of things that God hates. And in Proverbs 6 verse 17, as he enumerates those things God hates, he says in verse 17 that God also hates a proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood. One of the things that a Christian has to be very careful about is being deceptive with his tongue. Lying, slandering, cheating, using it for malicious purposes or intents, that's something we've got to avoid. You know, every person has to struggle with. It may not be as though a person is just an out-and-out liar, but there are often times in our life when it'd be easier not to tell the truth or to maybe fudge on the truth a little bit. Christian cannot use his tongue or his lips for lying or deceptive purposes. There are several passages in the Bible that teach us this. Colossians 3 verse 9 says to the Christian, "Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds." You're no longer in that old body. You're no longer living according to the world and according to sin. Therefore, don't lie to one another anymore. Proverbs chapter 12 verse 22 furthers the idea of lying when it says, "Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who act faithfully are His delight." Proverbs again 6:17, a proud look and a lying tongue, those are things that God despises. And so I want to make sure in my life that as I speak, as I relate to others, that I'm honest, that I'm true, that I'm open, that I'm not lying, that always try to tell the truth and do what's right with my tongue. Then the Bible teaches us from the book of Proverbs that our speech ought to promote health and healing and goodwill toward other people. I want you to look in your Bible in Proverbs chapter 12, verse number 18. Notice what God says about the tongue here. "There is one who speaks like the piercing of a sword, but the tongue of the wise promotes health." You ever known people who are just kind of total opposites in this area? There are people, I know people and you probably know people, that if you get around them and you hear them speak very long, it's like getting pricked with a sword. It's like getting stabbed with a sword. It's like somebody said, being around some people and listening to them talk is kind of like petting a porcupine. It's going to hurt eventually. Well, there are people like that. They don't have much good to say. They're always negative. They're always running others down. And they do so much harm, as it were, piercing people with their tongue. Their tongue is their weapon, as it were. And then there are other people, the tongue of the wise. Rather than being like poking somebody with a needle or a sword, they promote health. The Christian, his speech ought to promote health and healing. When you're around a Christian and you hear him talk, you ought not to feel like you've been poked with a needle or prodded with a goad. Rather, we ought to be encouraged and uplifted from that. Listen to 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 11. The Bible says this, "Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing." Hebrews 3:13 says, "But exhort one another every day, as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin." We ought to encourage, uplift, build up one another. We can all think of maybe messages or sermons or readings in the Bible that we read. Or man, you get through reading that and you're uplifted, you're encouraged, you're ready to go out and conquer the world. And then like we said, you can imagine visiting with some folks and you feel like the world's gloom and doom and everybody's bad and evil and you just don't have much motivation to go and do. How are we going to use our tongue? Going to use it to encourage? Or is it going to be like getting stabbed with a needle or a sword? And so let's use it to encourage and uplift other people. One of the things that the Bible clearly teaches is that the Christian should use his tongue to avoid gossip. Avoid using your tongue for the purposes of gossip. Now, when we talk about gossip, the book of Proverbs will use sometimes the word slander, a malicious intent. It'll use backbiting or a busybody. The Bible will use those words as well. But we all know what gossip is. When somebody hears something, they may not know it's true, and their motives probably aren't really to help or do any good, but they've heard something and it's juicy and it's entertaining almost and it's exciting, and they tell that and everybody looks at them as the source and think, well, how did they know that? They're so important. And that just begins to spread and it changes and it moves and it becomes a monster in and of itself before it's all said and done. Gossip has done so much harm by the tongue and in the Lord's church. Listen to what the Bible says about that. I want you to take your Bible and I want you to look with me in Proverbs chapter 11, verse number 13. The Scripture records these words, "Whoever goes about slandering reveals secrets, but he who is trustworthy in spirit keeps the thing covered." What's the heart and the attitude of this person? The slanderer, he's all about telling everybody secrets. I used to know some people, and we've all known people like this. Anytime anything happened, first thing they do is pick up the phone and begin to call people. They get on the gossip line and they begin to tell everybody else or email or Facebook or text or whatever it may be, and they just want to spread that dirt everywhere. Friend, is that really the way to use the tongue? No, the Bible says the one who's trustworthy, that's the one who can keep a thing covered. Well, maybe I heard something, and maybe that wasn't really good, and maybe it's really bad, and maybe I could get a little bit of pride, and people might look at me and think, wow, how'd he know that? And I might could tell others, and then no, that's not the person that God really wants. That's not how God wants us to do things. Rather than spreading all that dirt, we need to keep it covered. Don't go around spreading everything you know just because you know it. There are some things that need to stay covered, bad things. We don't need to go around telling that, and especially, you know, when people's intent is not what it ought to be. Listen to Leviticus 19, verse 16. Going all the way back under the old law, God spoke about gossip. God said this, "Do not go about spreading slander among your people. Do not do anything that endangers your neighbor's life. I am the Lord." You know, even in the camp of Israel, God knew it'd be a problem. People living that close of proximity, knowing each other that well, traveling together, God says, "I don't want you going around spreading slander. Don't be gossiping, backbiting, and being a busybody in somebody else's business." Listen to Proverbs chapter 11, verse number 9. The Bible says, "With his mouth, the godless man destroys his neighbor, but through knowledge, the righteous will be delivered." And so we need to realize that it's not my business and it's not my right to go around telling everything I know. You know, there are people who do this in the Lord's church and it sows a lot of discord. And that's one of the things that God hates. You don't need to be telling stuff on people just because you know it. And just because you've heard something, that doesn't give you the right to spread that or to tell everybody that. You know who the bigger person is? The bigger person is the one who can keep a secret, who may have heard something but knows. The godly person, the person who's really living a life of wisdom, is the person who may know something, but he's also got enough wisdom to know that doesn't need to go any further. Imagine how much good it would do if the gossip stopped with one person and it never went any further. Let's do our part to do just that. One last teaching from the book of Proverbs about the tongue, and it's such a wonderful idea here. The Christian, the godly person's tongue, it should be used for kindness and to encourage and be kind to other people. I want to direct your attention to Proverbs chapter 31, verse number 26. Would you open your Bible there? This individual that we're mentioning in Proverbs 31 is also known as the virtuous wife or the virtuous woman. Her beauty, her godly life is exalted in this chapter through several verses there. But here's one of the characteristics of her tongue. She opens her mouth, Proverbs 31:26. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness. What law does her tongue live by? What guards her speech? Whatever she says, she tries to say it as kind and as loving as she can say it. Friend, oh that we were all, that we had that attitude, that every one of us had that attitude, that when we opened our mouth and words rolled off our tongue, that they were covered in the law of kindness. Kindness needs to be a part of everything we say and do. Even when we have to discipline our children, even when we have to say things that are difficult, even when we say things that we know most of the world doesn't agree with, we want it to be said in kindness and love and to people to know our motives. You know, the greatest thing we could say in kindness today is that God loves you deeply. God loves every individual deeply, and He wants them to be saved. God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. Isn't that some of the most beautiful words to roll off anybody's tongue? John 3:16. God wants all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. 1 Timothy 2 verse 4. God's not slow concerning His promises, as some men count slowness, but He's long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. 2 Peter 3, verse number 9. In love and kindness, we want you to know today that God wants you to be saved, that He loves you, and that He has done everything possible to make salvation available. So much so that He gave us His best gift. It's true. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Romans 3, verse 23. It's sad, and it's true also that the wages of that sin is death, Romans 6:23. My friend, here's the good news. Here's the love of God and the kindness of God. God so loved the world, He gave. God made a way to be saved from sin. Listen to the second part of Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death, but, aren't you glad that's there? But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. My yoke is easy, my burden is light. Come unto me and I'll give you rest." Those are words of love and kindness from the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And friend, we want to encourage you today, if you have never obeyed the gospel, maybe you've never put on the Lord Jesus Christ, why not do that today? Because we love your eternal soul, because we want you to go to heaven, we also want you to know what the Bible says about salvation. Friend, there can be no salvation without Jesus Christ. He is the only way, the only truth. He's the only life. John 14, verse number 6. Without Christ, there's no hope. But the good news is anybody who's willing to listen to the Bible and do what God says can be saved. Do you believe that Jesus is truly the Savior of the world? In Acts chapter 8, as Philip is traveling down the road with the Ethiopian eunuch, he's been telling him about Christ, and he finally gets the point. Here's water, what hinders me from being baptized? If you believe with all your heart, you may. Friend, we encourage you today to believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God and as the Savior of the world. Have you changed your way of thinking, changed your way of acting? Would you turn to God in repentance? Peter preached in Acts 3, verse 19, to repent and turn that your sins may be blotted out. Turn from a life of sin, a life of hurt, and a life of ungodliness to Jesus Christ. Would you then be willing to make that good confession? I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, Acts 8, 37, Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. And having done those things, to have every sin washed away, would you be immersed in water? Friend, to become a child of God, the Bible clearly teaches you must be baptized in water. Listen to what Jesus said. How plain is this? Jesus said, "He that believes and is baptized will be saved. He that does not believe shall be condemned." What are the two things Jesus said you've got to do to be saved? He that believes and is baptized will be saved. Listen to what Peter said in Acts 2 verse 38. Repent and be baptized for the remission of your sins. Listen to what Jesus said to Nicodemus in John 3 verse 5. Unless a man is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. And the Apostle Paul, who had his whole life turned around by Jesus Christ. You remember in Acts 9 when he was told, you go in the city, it'll be told you what you must. Lord, what would you have me to do? Go in the city, be told you what you must do. Paul recounts that must in Acts 22, 16. He is told by Ananias, arise and be baptized and wash away your sins. Yes. The Bible says baptism does now also save us. 1 Peter 3, verse 21. And so we want to encourage you, friend, to obey the gospel. And maybe if our tongue hasn't been used for the right things, maybe we've said words that weren't right. Maybe we haven't spoken the truth at times. Or maybe we've been involved in gossip or slander. Friend, you can turn away from that. You can ask God for forgiveness and you can begin again to use your tongue to magnify and glorify God. Our hope and prayer today is that you'll do just that. We hope you'll continue with us in our study of the book of Proverbs next time as we think more about the unsearchable riches of Christ. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wife.
This is the gospel of Christ.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study material, as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form. Or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905. Or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee, 37111.
This is the gospel of Christ.